Hello, everybody. Welcome to the first foundation talks launched internationally on the web.
Hello, everybody.
Let me introduce myself. I'm Thomas Velos, the director of the Systemic Department at the Institute of Philosophy and Complexity Science, known as IFICC. This talk is organized in collaboration with the Center Leo Apostel in Brussels, Belgium, known as CLEA. The dissemination of scientific knowledge at CLEA has always been at the highest level, as important scientists such as Ilya Prigogine, Heinz von Forster, Bas van Frasen, and Francisco Varela have participated in their lectures, workshops, and symposium. In particular, the foundation talks that we are here today have occurred since 1995 to discuss fundamental scientific problems and research methodologies from an interdisciplinary perspective. IFICC, on the other hand, is a relatively new institute with also an interdisciplinary and philosophical orientation to the study of scientific problems. IFICC have organized a large number of lectures during the last years and have gathered experience on online transmission of knowledge, doing course and talks and many other things. During the last 2 years, IFICC and CLEA have collaborated on scientific research. And now, for the first time, we co-organize a scientific event. The idea of launching these foundation talks internationally on the web emerged from the need to provide an intercultural and interdisciplinary context that overthrows the limits imposed by physical frontiers. We call to our attendants, and particularly to other research institutes and universities, to join on further versions of this initiative. We expect to expand the network of institutes participating in this initiative and organize foundation lectures in other places of the world. I would like to take this opportunity to thank the director of IFICC, Dr. Pablo Raceto, the director of CLEA, Dr. Diederik Aerts, and the founders of Matristica, Jimena Dávila, and our lecturer, Dr. Maturana, for making this event possible. Our lecturer, Dr. Humberto Maturana, studied medicine and biology at the University of Chile and has a PhD in biology from the Harvard University. Among his principal contributions, he created the biology of cognition, the concept of autopoiesis, introduced the ideas of structural coupling and structural determinism, natural drift, and the biology of love, among others. He has published a number of influential articles and books, including Autopoiesis and Cognition and The Tree of Knowledge, and has been awarded with the National Science Prize in Chile and the New Civilization Prize here at IFICC. Dr. Humberto Maturana's lecture is entitled Natural Evolutionary Drift. There will be a chat available for attendance remotely, and there will be a question session after the talk, getting questions from the public here and also from the web. So please join me on welcoming Dr. Maturana.
Ahora. It's wonderful, isn't it? You modify the structure and something else happens. And something else happens in the mind, in the soul, and you clap. For what? For the change of structure of the microphone? Or for your expectations? I think that you have clap for your expectations. But the expectations are never fulfilled. One's own expectations are not fulfilled, and the expectations of others are not fulfilled. So, knowing that our expectations, yours or mine, will not be fulfilled, we are free to listen. You to listen, no expectation. I to speak without expectations also. And of course, with some Spanish nuances in the pronunciation of my English. And of course, I thank you for your curiosity, the fact that you are here and have not yet left. Thank you very much. I am going to talk about several things in order to come eventually to speak about natural evolutionary drift. And this notion of natural evolutionary drift is something that acquires its presence, its expression, more completely in a work that I publish with Jorge Podosis about the origin of species by means of natural drift. And I shall tell you what is this and how come that one can say that. And I shall begin with that which supposedly all of you know, which is molecular autopoiesis. We living systems are molecular autopoietic systems. And this is not a definition, this is an abstraction. In fact, in 1960, I was giving a lecture in the medical school of the University of Chile about the organization of living systems, the origin of living systems. And I was a very young man, I was only 32, believing that I could answer every question that the students might wish to ask. And at the end of the five lectures that I was teaching, one student make the following question. He said, you say that living system began on Earth some 3,800 million years ago. What began 3,800 million years ago that you can say now, or you can claim now, that living systems began then? And I could not answer that question. So I blushed several times and said, I cannot answer that question. But if you come next year, I shall propose an answer. So very wisely, I gave myself a year to propose an answer to that question. Now, questions are very interesting because they specify the answer that they would accept. But what one answers is not the question made by the other person, but the question that one hears. And we shall fundament this assertion a little further. And the question I heard is, what was conserved some 3,000 million years ago so that you can say now that living system began then? So I had to be able to know now, this means 1960, what living was, what living beings were, because I did not know, I could not claim what I had claimed about the origin of living beings. So I read biologists, philosophers, everybody that was writing in that time. Think 1960 is a very different moment historically in understanding biology, science, philosophy, chemistry, whatever it is now. So do not listen expecting that what is said that was being thought in 1960 should be listened according to what you think now. Attend listening to what was being said then. And I look at various books, writings. Some people wrote that the probability that the molecules, so many, many atoms of oxygen, carbon, nitrogen, sulfur, hydrogen, and so on and so forth, should be put together in a molecule of protein is so low that it cannot just happen like that. So something else was necessary. Others said that the complexity of living was so great that perhaps we shall never know what it is. Others said that living systems were composed of molecules of such and such and such a kind. And I thought, how do I know when the list is complete? Or others said that living systems were characterized by some functions, growth, reproduction, metabolism, blah, blah, blah. And I ask myself, how do I know when the list is complete? Because if I do not know when the list is complete, I do not know when what is being said indeed represents, evokes that what one wants to talk about living systems. So I began to ask myself, what must have been happening then in the constitution of some discrete entities such that we could say that the result of those processes were living entities? And this was my thinking, and then I decided to look into the laboratories of biochemistry, of molecular biology that were beginning then, and I look at the walls. And the walls were very interesting because they were propaganda of the biochemical companies which depicted molecular processes. For example, the synthesis of ATP. And you have a cycle. Molecules enter into this cycle, participate, other molecules enter, participates, and molecules come out, ATP, and other molecules. So you had a cycle process. Then you could look at the synthesis of glucose, the metabolism of glucose, and you had another cycle. And all the processes that were depicted, metabolic processes, were cyclical dynamics, with some linear aspect, but fundamentally cyclical. So I realized that indeed, what had to happen with living systems is that they were constituted by cyclical molecular processes in which the result were the living system. So the question was, what cyclical processes result in something that if I look at it as a discrete entity, I say, there is a living system. And, so living systems are molecular cyclical dynamics in which everything can change without ever interrupting the cyclical dynamic that produce let's say, network of molecular processes. Very good. So in that sense, living systems were closed systems. Yes, they were open to the flow of matter, to the flow of energy, but in their constitution, dynamic constitution, as molecular entities were closed. The word of topoiesis came much later, because I was reaching to this answer sometime in 1963, but the word of topoiesis, I thought that I invented it. Indeed, was a word used by Aristoteles some 2,500 years before. But good word of topoiesis. At the same time, I was studying perception, the nervous system. This was an epoch which was being permeated by the theory of communication of Shannon and Biddle. I think so. When he and his colleague proposed in sometime 1949 their notion and their theory of communication. And the word communication is a very, I would say, mischievous word. For example, if you have a window, you say, well, this is a manner of communication of this room with the other room, the window. I can go through. Or the doors there in the back. It's a manner of communication of this room with the garden. One can pass from one side to another. So the notion of communication began to be referring to the passing something from one place to another, which was information. In 1981 or 82, I don't remember exactly, I wrote an article to, which is, by the way, published in the El Sentido del Humano, an article about Professor Luco. Professor Luco was a very distinguished professor of the Catholic University, neurobiologist, did very interesting work about differentiation of the nervous system, and it was being celebrated his 50 years of working in the Catholic University. And I was asked to write something in relation to that. So I went to visit him, we talked, we were good friends, and he gave me a collection of his articles. And I found out something very interesting. Before 1952, nerves conducted nerve impulses. After 1952, nerves conducted information. Interesting. The notion of information was penetrating everything that we did, in psychology, in neurophysiology, in economics, everywhere. But what was so surprising for me was to find that Professor Luco said, before 1952, nerve fibers conduct nerve impulses, and after, nerve fibers transmit information. Why do I mention that? I mention that which I realized in 1980, not in 1960. Because the way one speaks guides what one does. The words that one uses guide our thinking, our understanding. Now, presently, in Matristica, Jimena and I and our colleagues speak about human beings being biocultural entities, implying that you cannot separate the way of living from the dynamic of realization of the living. But I shall come to that a little later again. In the 60s, I wanted to understand the phenomenon of perception, because it was said that the nervous system obtained information from the environment. And I asked myself, how is this information obtained? I don't want to speak about the background from which I was thinking it, but that was the question. And if you have look at the book, The Tree of Knowledge, you may remember there a reference to an experiment with the salamander, with rotation of the eye, which results in that the salamander, when has the eye rotated, the other eye is covered, and you present a worm, she throws her tank with a deviation equal to the amount of rotation of the eye. And so I wanted to see how is perception occurring. So I began to study about color vision, how colors are captured, are perceived, what processes occur in the nervous system. Now, this was a question that could not have been done 10 years earlier because of the disposition of the equipment and understanding to do that. But when I was doing that work, I realized that the object did not tell the eye what it was. If you have a flower, the light reflected by the flower or emitted by the flower reached the eye, and one said that this light carried the information that the eye captured and had to decode so that could say, ah, there is a flower. But if you try to see how that happens, you find out that does not happen as one seems to believe that happens, that the light from the flower carries the information. That the flower, through the light that it reflects, is telling the eye what it is, but it doesn't happen that way. Because if you look at what happens when the light that comes from the flower reaches the eye, reaches the photoreceptor, what you discover is that it triggers a structural change in some of the photosensitive molecules in the photoreceptors. And this triggers some structural change in the membrane so that the resistance of the membrane changes and the flow of current changes, and that activates at the level of the connection of the photoreceptor with the other nerve cells of the retina the secretion of some neurotransmitter. And nothing of this has anything to do with the flower. It's triggering some structural change in the nervous system, which has to do with the nervous system and not with the flower. Well, if you take this seriously, then you discover that perception is not what one thinks that it is, when one is thinking in terms of information. The eye, the nervous system, does not capture information, does not capture what is outside there. It occurs something else. And the question was, what is the something else? Because normally if you have a frog or a salamander and you put a worm there in front, the salamander or the frog throws his tongue, hits the worm, and eats it. How does it happen? If the worm doesn't tell by itself or by the light that it reflects that it is a worm that is there, it means that something else is occurring. And I realize that the nervous system operates as a growth system, making internal correlations of relations of activity within itself that result in some sensory effect of correlations which appear as the behavior. And this showed that the fact that the salamander threw its tongue and catched the worm is the result of a historical coherence. The historical coherence is evolution. The process of evolution results in that when the salamander is there and there is a worm there, it throws its tongue and captures the worm, but the worm is not telling the salamander what it is. When you take the key to open the door of your house, it opens the door. What happens there is a structural coherence that has to do with the history of design and construction of the lock of the house and the key. It's a historical correlation. It's not a question of that one tells the other something. They encounter because are coherent with each other. So the nervous system was closed. And the organism, the living being, was closed too in its dynamics. Oh, this is interesting. The external world that for us is so important because we see it there, that not specify what happens in us, triggers in us something that is the result of a historical process in which the organism, we, have changed together with the circumstance, such that when we are in certain circumstances, the coherence of the whole situation, historical coherence, results in that something is triggered in us that is adequate to the circumstance. Very well. So, history, evolution. Now, if we come to evolution, the questions that biologists were asking themselves in earlier 17th century were about how do the organisms operate adequately in the environment in which they are. The question of Darwin, how is it that organisms under medium are coherent? How does an organism adapt to new situations? And in front of this situation, he is thinking in his time, 1800, let us say, since 1835 until 1859, when he publishes his book, The Origin of the Species by Means of Natural Selection. So he was looking for an explanation of adaptation and change of adaptation. Perhaps in his trip around the world, he found situations that were at least telling him that something must have been occurring, because he found in the continent organisms that resemble organisms of Europe but live in different conditions, were adapted, coherent with different environment. Particularly in his visit to the Galapagos Islands, he did not fully understand what was happening, but he was discovering that in the Galapagos Islands were birds that were related to birds in the continent that was more than 1,000 kilometers away. But live differently. One would say were adapted to different conditions of existence. How was that? How was that those birds which came here accidentally became adapted to these new conditions? So this was his task, to explain adaptation, to explain how organisms that were living in one way began to live in a different way, such that whenever one looked to an organism, whatever its shapes, its character, was found in coherence, in adaptation to the circumstance. And adaptation makes reference, the word adaptation makes reference of being adequate to the circumstance, and the circumstance adequate to it. And he needed a mechanism, a process that would explain this. In times in which it was thought that any change required the action of a force, Newtonian thinking, what is the force that acts so that this organism becomes adapted to new circumstances? We even now say you have to adapt to the new circumstances. So adaptation was a variable. There were organisms well adapted and not well adapted. And those well adapted survive, and those that were not well adapted did not survive. And for that, including the notion was proposed of selective pressure, the force. There was a force, selection, that pushed the organism to change. But if we think now, 1960 onwards, to look at the organism and discover that it is a closed system in terms of the molecular dynamics, its organization was such that all the processes involved in it resulted in the network of processes that produced them. Those molecules that did not participate, other remain inside or went out. The molecules that came from the outside and did not participate in that went out or came, remained there, or participated. But the dynamic was closed. And the dynamic of the nervous system was closed as well. What was happening? When you find yourself in a situation like that, I'm going to make a drawing here. I'm going to put here an observer. A multisensory observer. As my colleague Jimena insists that we cannot just put it an eye there, I should put the whole multisensory organism. Sees this living system, and I draw it as an arrow closed on itself, a molecular system. I'm speaking of molecular systems, which produces itself, and molecules come in, and molecules come out. But exists in a medium. And if one looks at the history, what one sees some of you perhaps may remember, if you were fortunate to have your grandmother living with you, sometimes the grandmother has seen the child when it was 7 years old, for some time does not see him, and then he sees that this child at 22 is a doctor. And she said, oh my goodness, how did you transform? How much effort must have taken you to become a doctor? But does not see the history. Because here is the doctor. The boy or the girl has a different shape, has been transformed, and the circumstances in which he or she lives is different, is the medium in which a doctor is a doctor. And she saw the child here in the zero, and here in the N, and she asked, how did it happen that from here you came here? Mystery. But if you look at the history, you will see no mystery. You will see a history of coherent transformation of the child and the circumstances in which it is living. When you were 7 years old, and you were coming late in the evening, from you were playing, maybe your mother may tell you, oh my dear child, kuna in English, your cradle. I have your cradle ready. And the child would say, mother, I'm not a baby anymore. I don't sleep in a cradle, I sleep in a bed. Oh, yes, yes, of course, but since you are my baby. So it means that there has been a history of transformation of the baby into a child, such that now the child sees himself or herself as a child, not as a baby, so the cradle is not the adequate circumstance for his sleeping. But if you look at the history, they have been changing together, congruently. This history is a history of transformation of the organism and the medium congruently. And the child has been living all this time. But the manner of living has been changing. Adaptation is not a variable. It's a constant relation. While the organism lives, is in structural coherence with its circumstance. Adaptation is not a variable, it's a constant relation in which organism and circumstance change together congruently, and when that change stops being congruent in between the organism and the circumstance, the organism dies. But this is a view completely different from Darwin's view. It's not a criticism to Darwin. Darwin saw what he could see, thought in his time what he could think. Impeccable, wonderful, transforming. He was trying to talk about how organisms adapt to new circumstances. But in his time he could not see that adaptation was not a variable, was a constant relation of coherence between organism and circumstance and change together. This is what I have called structural coupling. The structure of the organism and the structure of the medium are changing together. No, in an effort. Suppose that you are skiing. Some of you ski, please. Some of you ski. And how do you slide skiing on the hill surface? On the snow, of course. How do you do that? What do you conserve while you are going zzzz? What do you conserve? What do you conserve? Equilibrium. And how do you move? Conserving the equilibrium. Conserving your coherence with the circumstance that is appearing new at every moment. And how do you do that? Through your sensoriality. Suppose that you're walking on the street and then you step on a hole or in something that is a little lower and you falter or hit a stone. What do you say? I did not see it. I did not see it. That means that you guide your walk through your sensoriality. And you conserve equilibrium in a tangent with the circumstances in which you can conserve it. You are not adapting to new circumstances of the flow. You are sliding, conserving equilibrium. Isn't that interesting? Of course, in the times of Darwin, everybody was doing the same, because you cannot move without conserving equilibrium according to your sensoriality. If a person becomes blind, has difficulty in moving in a world which he or she moved through vision, through his visual sensoriality. But if it has grown for a long time being blind, he follows his sensoriality a different configuration of sensoriality and moves, and you see this person handling his circumstance very well, because he or she slide following the path through its sensoriality, in which its sensoriality of equilibrium or of space is being conserved. Every living system slides in its living according to a path that arises according to its sensoriality. Has nothing to do with being accommodated to a new circumstance. When you teach something, you teach a play of a dance of sensoriality in some particular domain of sensoriality. And so, the history of living systems is not a history of accommodation to new circumstances. It's a history of conservation of living according to the satisfaction of the sensoriality in which the organism slides, conserving its living. And when that is not satisfied, the organism moves. Dies. I said moves, I was saying muere, die. I confused myself with my sensoriality of language, Spanish and English. And what is adrift? Suppose that you go out in a boat. You are going from one place to another, and you know how to drive the boat, you have the instruments and so on and so forth, so you go far away, you don't see the coast anymore, but then a storm comes and your boat is hurried, is broken, the mast or the rudder breaks, or the if you had an engine, the fuel is finished. And in this, suddenly you find that you cannot guide the boat. What do you do? You despair? That's a possibility. You say, oh, thanks, I still have the radio. I can communicate with some place in the coast, and you begin saying SOS, help, help. And some in the coast answer this. And you say, here I am drifting. What happened? Well, the storm destroyed whatever parts of the boat, but I'm in the boat yet. But drifting, I do not know where I am, not where I'm going. And the Coast Guard asked the following question. Do you know where you were? And you say, because you were a good navigator, you say, yes, according to the time I was on such and such a time in such coordinates. And so the Coast Guard says, I'm going to meet you, but it will take me about 4 hours. What does the Coast Guard do? He looks at the map of the currents. This is telling me what? 10 minutes. He looks at the map of the winds, the currents, and he can plot according to the winds and the currents and the movement of the sea, which path will you follow in your drift? You and your boat are desperate. You do not know where you are and in which way where you are going. But he or she knows where you are, according to where you were, and according to the wind, the currents, and so on and so forth, and can go into a path that intersects with yours. So for you yourself, you were drifting. You were not controlling the path. For the coast guard, you were not drifting. Or so you were drifting, but he knew where you were and where you were going, because you were moving in the coherences of the circumstance. So drifting is not and just anything. It's moving according to the circumstance in a way in which a person cannot say which way will go unless he knows the whole environment in which it is moving. Yes. The history of living system is a drift. Ladies and gentlemen, I congratulate you for your history of drifting from your childhood to now, such that you are here smiling with what I say. I could say, I study the life of every one of you, I would say, sometime with Jimena. This is why we ask who's coming and so on and so forth, and we found where you were born, what schools did you go, what did you did along all your years, and you were all coming to this meeting now along your life. Look at your history and you will find your work, everything brought you here, and it's not true. You are resulting here. You were not coming here, not myself. But one does not move just haphazard. One moves according to the coherences of the circumstance in which one is, following what one conserves as a living being through its sensoriality. So the natural history of living being is adrift. The diversification of living system arises through variation of what is conserved, but it's always adrift. Natural evolutionary drift says the history of living system is a natural, spontaneous drift in which every organism follows a path in which it conserves its living in coherence with the circumstance, because adaptation is a constant, does not adapt to new circumstances, arises, results in new circumstances according to the observation of the observer, but it moves conserving adaptation. Natural evolutionary drift is the history of conservation of adaptation, in which the manner of living in change is changing, the form of adaptation may be changing and indeed has changed, but not through a variability in adaptation, but through the conservation of adaptation. And this is what naturally evolutionary drift means. If I look at the result, I see differential survival and may speak about natural selection, if I wish. But the history is not guided by convenience, by better being better or worse than others, by the contingencies of the conservation, of sliding in the conservation of adaptation, in the encounter of two systems that have independent dynamics. The medium and the organism have independent dynamics, but the organism moves in the tangent in which its coherence with the medium is conserved. And sometimes they cannot do so and die, Sometimes there are variations that are produced in the reproduction of the organism, and new forms of living are conserved, but they are always conserved in the conservation of adaptation. Adaptation, coherence with the circumstances, is never lost. In the moment in which it is lost, the organism dies. Five minutes for me, but for us we can talk a little while after I finish. So when I would like to say something else at the beginning, and coming back to the beginning in these 5 minutes that are left. When living systems arose, some 3,800 million years ago, what arose? Molecular autopoiesis, yes, but what else? The medium in which it conserves its living. So what began when living systems began was a unity that we in Matristica call the ecological organism niche unity. Ecological organism niche unity. And what has been conserved along the whole history of living systems? Ecological organism niche unities. The medium is changing together. The whole biosphere is the present of history of this kind in natural drift, in which the different circumstances which are arising becomes part of the niche of the organism. I beg your forgiveness. Whatever I have said, better, whatever you have heard of what I have said, and I do not know what you have heard of what I have said, is now part of your niche. And you will carry this for a while, long or short period of your life, but it's part of your niche. The niche is changing continuously. In the niche, what you have is a dynamic in which sometime, coming from where you cannot predict, insights on the organism. And in the organism, you have a dynamic which is independent from the dynamics of the medium. And you have a response that you cannot predict. But the organism slides, conserving its molecular autopoiesis through its sensoriality. An encounter of two independent dynamics with the result that organism and niche change together congruently. No purpose, no intention, no better or worse adaptation. Natural evolutionary drift. But we, human beings, live in the relational space that we generate with each other. And there we can think, there we can reflect, change our sensoriality through changing our desires and purposes, and change the course of our drift, according to the circumstance which is arising in our living, in this medium in which our Nietzsche is being realized, changing with us. Now, I'm ready to answer any question that you may ask. I may say sometime I do not know, but I'm ready to answer all your questions. Thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Maturana. Thank you, Dr. Maturana, for giving us this very interesting lecture. I personally enjoyed, I guess you all enjoyed as well. Now we have a question session, but before starting, I would like to mention that there were an average of 90 people connected online. We were asking a little bit where they come from, and there are people from, so far they said, Belgium, Barcelona, from Venezuela. So not everybody answered the question, where are you watching us from, but it seems that the talk reached really a broad spectrum of positions in the earth. So we are really happy for that. So now if you have questions, I'll have to give you the microphone because we are recording, and also we will take a couple of questions from the online transmission. So, questions? Yeah, we will try to make one on one, okay?
Well, thank you. It's a question about the concept of adaptation. I read in some of your papers and articles that adaptation is a concept that we can apply not only to living beings but to other kinds of systems. Adaptation is not peculiar to living beings, but let's say to physical systems in general. I found that idea very interesting indeed, and my question is, so on the basis of that conceptualization, could we say that systems in general, living or not, evolve or change through time as a drift? So everything, not only living beings, are following a kind of structural drift and conserve adaptation in that very broad sense. And living beings is just a peculiar way of that phenomenon? Could we say that?
Yes, I would say that. The difference is that perhaps we do not see that this is happening in the same way, but it's happening the same way. For example, if you have a car, and you use it, and the car is being transformed along the history through its interactions with you, the way you handle it, and interactions with the medium. And if you want to sell it, and you go to a mechanic to have an assessment of the car, the mechanic will look at the structure of the car and will make some reflections about its history. For example, he'll say, oh my goodness, you have driven this car through very rough roads, for example. Of course you are guiding the car, but the car is reacting to the encounters according to the structure. And sometimes when you have an automatic car, and now are becoming even more and more automatics because they are increasing their sensoriality in the interaction, yeah, and inside, the dimensions involved in this history will be different. For example, you can have cars now that tell you when you are approaching too much to something else. And then you react according to that, according to your own sensoriality. Yes, this is happening the same with systems that we make. If you, in this play with balls, and one throws the ball and one wants to hit whatever number of standing pieces of wood you have there. The person that discovers the coherences of the encounter of the ball with the floor, the regularities of that, may be able to throw the ball in such a way that it and all the standing sticks fall. Others do not. But means that there is a regularity there that you can handle if you discover the nature of the coherences between the balls and the floor. So everything is moving that way. But with living system, this has to do with the conservation of living, the sensoriality. And the living is not an abstract of molecular autopoiesis. It is molecular autopoiesis, but it's the sensoriality, the inner sensoriality of the organism. And we can make reflections about our living, and then this becomes part of what configuration of sensoriality we conserve in our living. So this is always occurring as a drift, as a natural drift, but we can choose, we human beings can choose, because we exist in language and we can reflect. This is the gigantic difference with other living beings or mechanical entities that we may produce.
Thank you. People from all over the world keep greeting you, Doctor, from Switzerland, Portugal, and also many people from Santiago. One of the attendants named Carlos, which is in Santiago, asked the following question. How adaptation and cooperation coexist in the situations you have referred to in this talk?
Yeah. When do we cooperate? When do we say that we are cooperating with somebody else? It has to do with our sensoriality. We say that there is cooperation because we interact with the other, and the pleasure of interacting with the other and being with the other, and moving according to things that we express in terms of desires, which have to do with our sensoriality. And when we do not coincide or harmonize in the desires, we stop cooperating. So cooperation goes exactly in the same way. If we enjoy, we slide in the pleasure of doing things together, we cooperate. If we do not enjoy and do not have pressure in doing things together, we do not cooperate. Maybe we obey, maybe we submit, we do something else. It's a different emotional dynamics. But we are always being guided by our sensoriality, and we human beings, but what configuration of sensoriality we wish to live.
Are there any other questions from the public? Yep. Sorry, we need the microphone.
Thank you, Professor Maturana, for your talk. There was something that called my attention. You used the concept of sensoriality. Is this a property for all the molecular autopoietic systems? For a cell, for a mammal? Is this a property of the living? All the living things are sensorial or sensors?
I speak of sensoriality because I'm speaking of us living beings. But suppose that you have a molecule, a hormone, flowing in the blood. It will flow in the blood until it reaches, perchance, we would say, it reaches some molecule in the surface of a cell which is coherent in its structure with it. If it is coherent in its structure, they will unite and they will trigger in each other whatever changes result from that encounter. We will not speak about sensoriality. It's not claiming that the molecule has a particular sensoriality, but has a particular structure. and a structure that entails molecular configuration, or the atomic distribution or in the molecule, the charges, electric charges, and so on and so forth, so that there is a coherence or not. Maybe there is a coherence which reaches up to that, but not enough to trigger a particular normal structural change in the molecule that result in some other structural changes in the cell. This is when one puts an inhibitor, for example, or a molecule that resembles the hormone, but is not a hormone, but interferes with the action of the hormone. So what is involved always is structural coherence. But in us, we do not speak about the structural coherence. We speak about our sensoriality because we can talk about it, but it is structural coherence. Now, this is interesting. How come that those structural coherences arise? History. You know, you have read, presumably, about the same master in archery. You have, here I come, I want to learn archery, to throw the arrows. And here is the same master. Master, I would like to be your disciple and learn. And he says to me, pick the bow. And then he says, relax. Pick the bow, relax, relax. Must happen as if all things happen spontaneously. Good, good, good. Relax. He guides with this good, relax, good, relax your sensoriality. And then says, pick up the bow and let it extend itself. What is saying? Pick up the bow and the string and let it extend itself. Relax, relax, let it extend itself, relax, relax, until he doesn't say anymore, relax, and say, okay, now put the arrow. And in this process, eventually, the arrow goes and hits the target. Fantastic, without effort. Everything done in relaxation. And then Algin says, well, could you hit the target blindfolded? And you say, yes. So, here you come, stand here, there is the target, and they blindfold you. You pick up the bow, the arrow, blindfolded, throw the arrow, and hits the target. How do you do that? Are you cheating? No. How do you do that? Because that is the result of a process in which you and the circumstance are changing together. The only thing that you have to do is, let us make a little cheating here. You are blindfolded, you are picking the bow and arrow, and somebody shifts the target. The arrow does not go to the shifted target, goes to there where the target should have been. Unless you have cheated. And look. That is possible because there is a historical coherence that was being established. And this is happening. This is how any training occurs, any learning occurs. When I was studying medicine, I was invited by a professor of neurosurgery to see him, and he put me to look over his shoulder, to look at what he was doing. trusting that if this was done several times, eventually I would be able to do the same that he did. This is what you do with your students. A history of coherent transformation in which you and the circumstance change together. The Zen master is part of the circumstance. It's completely different for you when he says relax, relax, and when he says good. And what do you learn? Your body dynamics that result in that if you are standing in a particular place and you pick up the bow and arrow, the arrow will go in a particular path and will hit the target that is there. What is peculiar in us is that we can reflect. Once they invited me to do a talk in a school of music. I am not a musician, but I said to the students, there was a professor, I'm not going to speak to you about music. I'm going to speak about the most important words that you have been listening at. Relax, relax, good, good, good. Relax, relax, good, relax. And they say, yes. If you're learning to play an instrument, I mean, this is the most important guide of the teacher, which is relax, don't. Good. This is how one learns. Guiding the structural transformation that is taking place anyhow in the circumstances in which you are. If the circumstances are changing, then you are, since reality guides you. If they are not changing, you and your circumstances become one, and then you can do impeccable if everything remains constant.
Thank you. We have many questions coming on the chat, at least three more, so we will try to make time for all of them. So the next question comes from Jan Brukaert in Brussels, actually a member of CLEA. The question is, how do you relate natural evolutionary drift to the amans in Homo sapiens amans, which is mentioned in the paper? By the way, before the answer of Maturana, I'll mention that there is a paper being submitted to be published about the natural evolutionary drift. They have written something, and we are also producing or helping or cooperating on producing scientific articles. So because they come from CLEA and are interested more in the details, probably the question is a bit more technical. So, Professor, thank you.
Can you repeat the question now?
How do you relate natural evolutionary drift to the amans in Homo sapiens, amans, which is mentioned in the talk abstract?
How do you relate? With my colleague Jimena Davila in Matristica, we invite to realize that we human beings belong to a particular kind of history that must have begun about 3 million years ago in some ancestral family, in which language arose through doing things together. But for that to happen, that we do things together, we must enjoy being together. And we cannot be quarreling. We must be enjoy, must be a pleasure. Which is what happens with the children. With the children when they are growing, if we are not adults thinking that they have to satisfy certain expectation of us, we speak with them, we explain, we show how things are done in the pleasure of being together. Now that element of pleasure of being together in the origin of language, we introduce by the notion of amans. Let things happen without expectation, without demands. Let them occur in respect. and we speak about Homo sapiens amans. In this about 3 million years that we think must take in since the beginning of this, there have been many histories of drift, and we are members of one in which we are still amans. The baby is born in trust. The baby is born in the implicit trust that it will be taken care of, that will not be abused, but sometimes abuse is betrayed. But we are born in this, and this is what we mean, that we are, as a psychic, so to say, species, Homo sapiens, amans. Sometimes some lines go Homo sapiens, amans, aggressans, because the manner of living, for some reason, since the baby is born, is different, or even before the baby is born. Because the way we relate with our babies since the conception is part of the niche in which they are growing. So this expression acknowledges that we would not be the kind of human beings in which we care for the other if we did not belong to history of amans. The present, the origin of the present, can only be understood by thinking what must have been conserved before such that we are as we are now. But it's most likely we all know, either because we have been parents, mothers, or elder brothers or sisters, that when a baby is born and you hold it in your arms, you find a little being that relaxes on you unless you are tense. If you are tense, doesn't relax. But if you are relaxed, relaxes and is well. Is born amans. Trusting implicitly, not thinking in the way it is made that has result of its evolutionary history of natural drift since about 3 million years ago to the present, in which the baby is born in a way such that sometimes we say, almost as if it were saying, if you care for me, if you treat me with respect and love, I shall grow to be a serious, responsible, and democratic adult. We will have to speak about what democracy means, but democracy occurs only in mutual respect. If there is no mutual respect, there is no democracy. So if you treat this baby with respect, with care, according to its make, grows in a trusting medium in which its sense of reality guides him or her according to the way you relate with him or her. That answered the question, or I went adrift?
Okay, so we take another question from the public. Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you very much. That was a wonderful talk. But I got a more than a question. I was wondering if you could elaborate a little bit more about the concept of coherence, because you use it in a molecular, ecological, psychological, and in many different ways. So could you elaborate a little bit more?
When we say that two things are coherent, we mean that somehow the relation is not in conflict. There is no conflict in the relation. If you face a lock and you take out your key and doesn't open the door or open the lock, what do you think? My goodness, I'm mistaken. This is not the key. this key is not coherent with the makeup of the lock. And just point. Yes, this is the key. Because what it does in the introduction with the lock is something that results in a process that is adequate at the circumstances in which the key and the lock were being used. So coherence does not mean any more than that. It's not something mysterious. When somebody makes a statement and you say, oh, but that is incoherent with what you said before. So I cannot see a relation. It's I who is making the opinion. I'm saying it's incoherent. I cannot see a relation in which what you say now comes is related in an adequate manner with what you said before. This is what coherence means. Not more, not less. But in living system, coherence or incoherence triggers changes of sensoriality. For example, you pick up your jacket and put it on and you feel uncomfortable. You feel uncomfortable, you take it out, oh, I put it through the wrong side. Was inside out, so I transform it and I put it, and now I feel well, coherent. I once went to California for circumstance X. I had a car and went in Los Angeles near the about 5 o'clock or something like that, near the beach, but there was a dune, so I left the car and went up and began to walk down, and I felt uncomfortable. Something was not comfortable. Maybe I am tired with the trip, I came out too soon, came down to the car, and I felt well. And I repeated until I realized that my shadow was on the wrong side. Here in Chile, if I go to the seaside in that particular time of the year, the sun may be there, and my shadow is to my left. But if I go to the other side of the equator, and I stand near the sea, the sun is there, my shadow is on the right side. But if I'm standing there with my sensoriality, I was just arriving. So I treat my situation with my sensoriality of being on the south of the equator, so I felt uncomfortable. It was very interesting. I had never had happen something to me like that. And I think that had to do with the shortness of the period. I leave nothing getting into the plane and coming out, and an hour after that going to the beach and find myself with the shadow in the wrong side. It means that one is coherent with many more dimensions than one thinks. This has to do with our sensoriality. So coherence only means a reference to the fact that the circumstance is not contradictory. It operates in a manner that corresponds to the operation of the different elements that participate in it. Remember, the words, all that they do is to evoke in the listener something that happens in the listener. With Jimena, we say, we are completely not responsible of what you hear from what we say. But we are completely responsible for what we say and the moment in which we say it. we always expect that the other understands what we say in terms of what we say, and this never happens. If you applaud what my lecture was, you are applauding the charm that you felt or the whatever happened to you during the lecture. And I am grateful for that, I like it. But if somebody stands up and says, oh, rubbish, it's his or her rubbish. It doesn't have to do with what I'm saying or what the other person is saying, because when you fall in love of a lady, you fall in love of what happens to you with the lady. You are falling in love with yourself. Look, this is not bad, because due to this we can do things, because we are plastic, we change the flow of our interactions, we can reflect. And this is the greatest treasure, we can reflect and choose whether we want or do not want to feel what we feel.
Okay, I'm not gonna stand because the question is a bit long, I cannot remember, but it's from someone called Space Weaver, which is not yet identified. His location is not yet identified. His text is as follows. Thank you, Humberto, for a deep presentation in very simple terms. A question. What is special about human reflection that allows it to have a direction and not only a drift? How such direction is conceived? He comes from CLEA as well,
yes.
Brussels.
Thank you. Reflection does not alter drifting, changes your position in your space, and hence the drift that you follow is different. Drifting is always taking place. You are following the path of your sensoriality. You may imagine a result, but the result is not there. It's the way you are now that you are imagining. Not as a result already, but what you think is the result is not what will happen there, but what you feel now. So in a reflection, what happens is, here I am standing in my circumstance in this way, and I reflect. For example, I think, oh my goodness, I want to be in this moment in somewhere else. Yes, I want to be. I change my position, and the path of my natural drift changes. This is why the reflection is interesting, because the reflection consists in adopting, through what we think, a different configuration in the circumstances in which you were. And you see differently, and you drift in a different direction. For example, you may have heard somebody saying, don't speak to me of that, I don't want to know it. Has happened to you? What this person is saying? I do not want to happen to me the change of sensoriality that will happen to me if we talk about that. It means that I know that already. You see, it's a complex situation, but it always has to do with how do I feel and how I want to feel. If I feel tired and I do not want to feel tired, this not wanting to feel how one feels is a feeling and determines, transforms the structure. If you were to put sensors in all the muscles, you will see how the configuration of sensoriality in your muscles changes with what you think. And if you put also sensors for hormones, for neurotransmitter, for whatever it is in your blood, you will see also that all this changes with your thinking. Because we are a unity. This ecological organism needs unity. It's a dynamic entity. Doesn't have fixed edges. The organism has borders that are being determined by the molecular autopoiesis, but those also are changing. not very fast. But if you look at yourself, you will observe that in the course of days you change it. But we human beings may express preferences, desires, which define how we move, what do we conserve as we slide in the realization of our living. This is why when our mothers used to tell us, malos pensamientos, bad thoughts are not good for the soul. Do not have bad thoughts. Because it's not the same to think with anger from to think with respect. And this is not a failure, this is how we are, and this is how, being this way, we have done the most wonderful things and the most horrible things, we human beings. So we can choose according to what we want to happen in our living. If we say in our drifting, if I said you are all drifting, this is, we hear it badly. I mean, don't be drifting, have a purpose. Yes, I have a purpose, but I shall be drifting in the conservation of something that is my purpose. So drift does not have a value. This word does not have a value, has to do only with the nature of the process. And it's natural drift because it's happening in the cosmos, not only in us.
Okay, we take another question from the public and probably one more question later from the online transmission, and probably will be the finish, depending on how long it takes.
Hello, I have a question. What happened with the autopoiesis when the medium doesn't allow an ecological unity in terms of biological beings? That is my question. Thank you.
If the autopoiesis is not conserved, the living system disintegrates. Now, depending on what kind of living system is what remains. We may die and our hair may continue growing and part of our physiological dynamics in our organs may go on, yes. But we as persons have disintegrated because that configuration of realization of autopoiesis that is being conserved in our living as a person, stop.
Yes, sometimes the medium doesn't allow an ecological unity. I mean, sometimes the mediums divide the human beings, for example.
Yes, and so you die.
But all we will die.
And no, but the niche,
despite of we'll die, we are always doing an autopoietic. We are autopoietic.
Yes.
If we die.
But with light, so for example, here, I come, you immediately think, did he see that this is the edge? Maybe he will fall, and I stop. Because I saw, I thought I avoid falling down. It depends on my sensoriality. So the medium, this is changing. All this is changing. The niche is only part of the medium. The niche is that part of the medium which appears in the interaction. The niche is not something there, something that arises with the living of the organism. There are no niches floating around. The niche arises with the realization of the living of the organism, and it's changing. I have said things and some Some of you would say, I forget it. And then tomorrow say, ah, interesting what I heard yesterday. So it was in your dynamics and appears in that moment consciously in your niche, but it's there somehow in your internal dynamics. Or not. You never remember it, forget it. I mean, it's nonsense. You see, it's the medium is much larger than the niche. You do not see the niche. If you want to see how a living being lives, you must let it live. If you go to the countryside and find an insect and you say, oh, how does this insect live? In order to know, you have to let it be. Because you do not see the niche. The niche will appear with the living of the organism. The same with all of us. I have no idea of the domain in which each one of you lives and thinks and reflects. And this means I do not know the niche, but even I do not know the more expanded domain in which the niche is realized, from which sometimes something unexpected appears. If I look at this properly, I approach to the possibility of deducing something that will happen. For example, I'm speaking in the trust that you understand English. How much, how come, I have no idea. But if I speak English and you do not understand me, surely you would stand up and leave. So I cannot predict what will happen. Besides that, if you are here and you know that I shall speak in English, you understand English, or you think that you understand English and that I speak English so that you think that you will understand what I say. And conversely. But we think and we want to control, to specify what happens to the other. This we cannot do, and if we insist in attempting to do that, we deny the person. We become aggressors, even not wanting to. I'm doing this for your well-being. How do you annoy the well-being of the other? In terms of humanness, yes, I know. I know that we all are breathing and consuming oxygen. And then we are speaking in English and maybe we are thinking in Spanish from what we speak in English. I do not know. But if we remain together, we transform together. And then, after we transform together, we begin to do things who are expanding in the domain of coherence. So it's beautiful that we human beings can do beautiful things, because that requires mutual respect, disposition to be with the other, wanting to be with the other. We can do marvelous things together. For example, this conversation. Look, there is a togetherness which goes through the internet to Belgium or to Spain or to other places. And each one is thinking there according to his own manner of being where he or she lives.
So there is time for a last question. From Marco Costa from Portugal, and the question is as follows. Could Professor Maturana explain the role, if any, of information in the context of human communication?
When we speak of information, we think that the sender of the message specifies what the other is going to listen. So I send this message and I think I'm sending this information. But the other listened something that has to do with him or her. So the information, if I want to speak that way, will be what the other does with what he or she heard, not what I was thinking that I was saying or doing. And this is why it's so interesting. We speak as if information went from here to there, and not, does not. Information occurs in engineering with that precision because the domain of alternatives in which I pick to associate some particular configuration with the message, and the domain of alternative from which I will associate what happens in the message with it, are the same. So if we are the same, then we're going to speak about transmission of information, because you will listen or hear the same what I want to say, because we are the same. Either in Spanish, for example, in English, and even there, we are not ever the same. So this is what the notion of information is misleading. In engineer, yes, it works because we specify the conditions. But in human relations, we cannot specify the conditions. Every one of you will be angry, hurt, furious with me if I wanted to specify what you think. I do not want to specify what you think. I'm making a performance. If you enjoy it, something happy, something good will happen to you. If you do not enjoy, maybe also something good will happen to you and say, no, I'm not interested. I do not know. But if we happen to encounter with each other in mutual respect, we happen to encounter each other in the disposition of conserving our relation, then something interesting will happen. When we speak about the problem of the Mapuches, it's not the problem of the Mapuches, it's our problem because we want them to be different than what they are. But if we do not want them to be different than what they are, then we may talk and may come to an agreement if we want to live together. It's in a different thing. But requires respect, honesty.
Okay. So now is the end of our first foundational lecture launched on the web. So we would like to thank Dr. Maturana for this really amazing talk, and also to all the attendants and the online attendants that were actually more than what we expected. And we have to say sorry to them because there were many, many questions that could not be answered this time. We will try to find a way to contact them and keep this discussion forward. And okay, so we would like to also recall our attendants all over the world and research institutes that this format of lectures, it's available for everyone. So if anybody wants to contact with us through our websites, you can do it so we can co-organize lectures in other parts of the world. So thank you again, and we hope to see you in our further and next talks. Bye-bye, thank you.
Thank you very much, thank you. Gracias, muchas gracias.